Hi everyone, welcome back to Vedic Life Coaching. Thank you so much for joining me. And welcome to the Sidereal Vedic Astrology Outlook for the month of November. Now, I'm recording this episode on the 18th of October, just 4 days after that big eclipse that we had. I'm going to cover my thoughts on that in the news matchup. So if you want to skip ahead to that part of the video, you can certainly do that. You can use the jump links below. If you are new here, welcome. Welcome to this channel. On this channel, you're going to find so many different things. I've got meditations. I've got my planet meditations, which you can check out. I've also got a wisdom gallery. And in that wisdom gallery, I have got all kinds of different videos that you can take a look at, interesting topics where we dive deep into Vedic astrology. I've also got master's episodes where I feature either, you know, a master of times gone by, someone famous from times gone by, or a living master. And those are my interviews that I do here. What else have we got? There's a lot of different things that you can check out. The other thing that I wanted to point you to, if you're new to Sidereal Vedic Astrology and you want to learn how to read a North Indian style Vedic Astrology chart, well, you can check out my guide. I've got a guide that I made and I use this guide every day in my readings. When I'm doing a reading for one of you guys, the part that I refer to the most is the lordships. The summary of the lordships in there is something that I myself refer to all the time. And I have put this guide together of how to read a chart from scratch. It's through my own knowledge. It's through having read lots and lots of books on this subject. But it's also, I've also definitely enjoyed the writings of B.V. Raman. And you'll see, you know, a lot of his influence in the guide that I've created. I often get asked the question, what are my favorite books on Vedic astrology? That is a question I get asked so many times. So I will share again. I don't mind. I will share this as many times as I need to. The first book is Light on Life by Hart Defoe and Robert Svoboda. The next book that I have in hard copy as well, both of these I have in hard copy. The next one is Nakshatras by Camilla Sutton. And also by Camilla Sutton, I refer to quite a bit her Vargas book. I actually don't know the title of that. I was one of the first people to buy it as soon as it launched. You know, I got the Kindle copy straight away as soon as it was ready to download. And I've forgotten the title of it. I'll put it by my side. But that is really a terrific read and reference book as well. I tend to refer to that. I haven't, you know, read it cover to cover, whereas Light on Life, I certainly have sat and read that cover to cover a couple of times. So those are really good books to get into. Now, before I get into the news matchup, this month what I'm going to do is I am going to do a bit of a news matchup. I'm also going to take a look at the energy for November. I'll even take a look at the energy of December in that section as well. I think we do need to look at November and December so that we can plan out the rest of the year. That's quite important. But before I get into any of that, I do actually have some question and answer bits from the community that I just thought would be really worth going through these. One of you has asked the question, do you use mean node or true node? That's a terrific question. I use the true node. And I once did an episode all about this, actually. I'll see if I can find it on the channel. I have done an episode where I talked about, you know, how in Vedic astrology, why there is mean node and true node, and how the moon, the ancients used to consider it to be a bunny rabbit hopping across the sky. Like, there's a whole science behind this. And you know, do you use the average node? Do you use a true node? Yeah, what do you use? I use true node because my software Parashara's Light 9.0 is using the true node. 9.0, version 9.0 does not give me the ability to switch to mean node. Isn't that interesting? The older versions of Parashara's Light did allow me to switch the node, but this current software doesn't, and I'm pretty sure it's calibrated to true node. I will double check that. I've got Jyotish dashboard on my iPad as well, and that does give you the option of using mean node or true node. I am pretty sure though that Parashara's light is just true node now, and it's kind of stuck there. You can't actually change it. So that's the answer to that question. I also wanted to answer this one. This wasn't a question actually. Someone just stated listening from moon sign rather than rising, since this is eclipse time. Yeah, this is an interesting point. This comment was left on the eclipse video, and it's basically stating that you should only look from the moon and not from the ascendant. That's absolutely fine. I'll give you an example of, you know, where it can be worth looking from the points of view of other planets. I'll give you an example of my chart. In my chart, this time, if I looked at the eclipse from my moon or my ascendant or my sun, I actually wouldn't get the information that I would get if I look from Venus's point of view. Well, now that's actually very interesting, because my Venus was right there, part of that eclipse. So, you know, this is something that if you know how to read a chart, you'll be able to read from different points of view. You'll also be able to read from, you know, the point of view of your husband, for example. If you're a lady, you'd look at from Jupiter, or you could look from the seventh lord. You know, if you're a man, you could look from the point of view of Venus or from seventh lord, things like that. You know, sometimes I get asked questions about looking from D9, that should we look at transits via D9? Absolutely. If you want to do that, you can. And with me, again, with me and my charts, I'm Virgotama. My ascendant and my Rahu Ketu axis is the same, D1 and D9. So I actually don't do this myself. This is something I haven't particularly experimented with too much. But I do look across my divisional charts, and I will look at planetary movements across divisional charts. You can do that. So in that instance, let's say your ascendants are different in D1 and D9. That's okay. In D9, for example, if you're looking at Saturn's transit through Aquarius, you just look at where Aquarius is in that D9 chart of yours, or in the D7 chart if you want to look up your children, or in the D12 chart if you want to look up your parents, you know, things like that. Like, you can read, and sometimes I have done that in readings where people have asked me to, from their charts, but not give me, they won't give me the charts of their people, but they'll say, can you read, you know, my family members? And yeah, I can, and that does work. So, you know, that's pretty interesting right there. But yeah, I just wanted to point out that, you know, you can listen from your moon sign only for an eclipse, that's fine. But then equally, you know, sometimes if you look more broadly, you will get more information, and that can be worth doing. The other thing I wanted to bring up was another question. Let's see, I've got this one here, which is, do you think some of our collective exhaustion could be coming from having so many planets in retrograde at this time? I thought that was a great question. This Mercury retrograde was particularly awful for me, and things seem to be improving since Mercury went direct. Yes, I fully agree with this view. I think that a lot of retrograde planets could have been making people feel exhausted. I blamed it on, because you know, that's what we do, we lay blame on the planets, don't we? What did I blame it on? Venus being quite stagnant there in Cancer, which is true. I have noticed that now things are moving forward in my life too. But it could be all those retrograde planets as well. And I did notice that Mercury that was retrograde just recently, I was planning to get so much work done there, and I got none of it done. It was terrible. I really thought I would have like all this content done and I could get ahead, and I just couldn't. It just did not work out. So yeah, it's interesting you've written Mercury retrograde was particularly awful for me, and things seem to be improving since Mercury went direct. That is my experience too. One of the things I love about this comment is that you're clearly observing how does this stuff work with your everyday life, and that's what I love. You're matching it up and you're observing. So look at that, you're in the driver's seat there, and that's really how to use this information. What I'm sharing here is just information, but you match it up and you observe and you will discover your own patterns, and then astrology will start to become your own, you know, and that's ideal. That's what we want. And I also just wanted to share a couple of just beautifully written comments. We have got such incredible people in our audience, and I just wanted to share these. This was about the English presenter I was talking about, and I was still going to call him the English presenter. And do you know why? I've been hearing by watching various podcasts and shows that talk about, you know, news here in the United Kingdom, I've heard that they want to pass laws to the effect of, you know, if I was to mention the English presenter's name, then this piece of work could end up in court or something like that. I like that. These are the kind of laws that people want to pass. I mean, it's just crazy what's going on out there. Will they be able to pass these laws? I don't know. But, you know, everyone has fantasies, right? And some of these people have fantasies too, that they want to have these extravagant kind of laws and such a level of control and surveillance and all this. Pluto in Capricorn, we know what's going on. But I just wanted to bring up these comments because these were great. These were so well written. And one of you has written, thank you for your commentary on RB, the English presenter. And you said that, yeah, you loved his Trues days. And I wanted to say, I used to watch the Trues as well, the True News. I used to love it. And I remember when he had, I think it was Ed Miliband, went to his house. And like, I watched all of that. I thought that was great. And I even read my bookie walk when that first came out. And I remember I was doing flat share at the time. One of my flatmates, she said to me, you've got to read my bookie walk. It's so funny. She said, you're just going to love it. And I did. I got it and I read it. It was really, really a brilliant read. What an incredible vocabulary he has. You know, it's really something to behold. So yeah, I wanted to bring up that comment, and I wanted to bring up the next one as well, because this was so beautifully written. I just had to share it with you all. And this one is great. I love this line here. Destroying lives via media is like the Roman Colosseum games, brutal entertainment for those devoid of compassion, ethics, and empathy. Absolutely. Yeah, I just thought that was such a great comment. So thank you, everyone, for being just incredible community members here. You know, we've got a really lovely comment section here. People are offering astrological insights, people are offering, you know, their stories, and of course True News. You know, if you're in a part of the world where there is chaos, and we've certainly got that at the moment, I'm just about to get into that now. Yeah, I will, you know, match up some of the recent events here. But if you are in a part of the world where things are chaotic, please do feel free that you share your story in the comments below, because from what I know, the comments aren't censored. And these days I do watch content on YouTube, but equally, you know, after I've watched whatever's there, I will spend quite a bit of time in the comments, and I learn the most amazing things from YouTube comments. It's really incredible. You know, just, yeah, the amount of real information and truth you can get from the comments section here on YouTube is pretty incredible. Let's take a look at the news matchup. I don't have too much to say. I just wanted to match up a couple of things. Because this one's bigger, so I'll start with the shorter one first, and I don't have notes for it, and that is the no vote that happened in Australia. And I haven't talked about that on the channel. I've been wanting to, but I haven't. And I wasn't sure what the result would be. And I'm actually pleased about the result, really. It might surprise some of you, but I'm on the no side. It might not surprise some of you, actually. Some of you are like, yeah, she's on the no side. I was on the no side. I thought no. And the reason I was on the no side was because I don't trust the government. And that's what I see the no vote represents. To me, it represents the fact that Australia has united in their mistrust of the government. That's what I see there. And I don't trust the government, you know. So people who voted no, I was on that side. People who voted yes, I understand that. Of course we want more power for Indigenous people. Absolutely we do. But the reason I was on the no side was because I was going on places like BitChute and places where people aren't censored And that's where I saw a lot of Aboriginal elders speak up and speak out and say, this is not something we want. And, you know, of course, you know, there are, in Australia, we want, you know, the history there to be sorted out. We really do want that. But we want the right model and we want the right thing going forward. And to me, the no vote was similar to what happened here in the United Kingdom, which was the Leave vote happened, like the Leave, you know, UK left, there was a whole Brexit thing. And I remember that, and I'm not particularly able to vote in Australia anymore, though I'm Aussie, but I don't vote there. I can vote here, but in the Leave vote here, I didn't vote. But my heart was for Leave, actually. And I was very quiet and shy about it. I never said anything because I thought my opinion was wrong. I also thought I don't have any ancestry on this land. I have no connection with this land. And I thought it would be wrong for me to vote. But my heart wanted Leave. And yeah, I was pretty sort of pleasantly surprised when I saw, wow, Leave has happened. You know, that's pretty amazing because just like in Australia, I believe in Australia, there was a lot of government funds and corporate money went into promoting yes, 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 you know, and the people have spoken. And that's very Saturn in Aquarius. You know, the people have spoken and they've united, I believe, in their mistrust of the government. And I see it as a good thing there in Australia. But, you know, equally, there are people who voted yes, and the people who voted yes, they wanted, what they want is they want an Indigenous voice there in the Parliament, I do believe. But I mean, we all want the Indigenous people to be treated fairly and more power, but it's got to be the right model. It's got to be the right thing. And from what I heard, as I say, from the Aboriginal elders, what they were proposing wasn't really going to be that. So that whole thing was interesting. It's interesting to match that up with the astrology because that no vote happened on eclipse day. It happened on Saturday the 14th of October, I do believe. It happened on the eclipse day. And it's like that the proposal was just eclipsed out. It was just thrown out. It was just like, no, you know, it was tossed out. Yeah, so pretty amazing. I also saw a clip of, I'll just tell you quickly, I think it was on Sky News, and was it Waleed Ali? Is that his name? I can't remember. He said something about that, oh, no voters aren't educated or something like that. And I really didn't like that view. I thought, oh gosh, that's, and they kind of did that here in this country too. They said people who voted Leave are uneducated people and things like that. Not at all. That is not the case at all. And I'll tell you, in this country, when Clive James was interviewed and asked, is he for Leave or Remain? I was very happy and surprised, again, pleasantly surprised to see he was a Leave guy. And yeah, that made me feel like better about my view, you know, because sometimes it's, you know, it can be hard to have an opinion, but anyway, that's where I stood on all those things. So where I do have a strong opinion, I will definitely share it. Now, where I don't have a strong opinion, I will tell you that as well. And here's the next item of news that I want to match up, and this is the disturbance in the Middle East. And I don't have a view on this. I don't understand. I'm trying to catch up on the history of what's going on there and how all of that works. I've been recommended that I should watch Gabor Maté's interview about this, and I'm going to do that this weekend. I'm saving it for the weekend so I can sit down and I can watch the whole interview and understand. And apparently he's a good person to learn from. He's going to set out the history and explain what's really going on there. But I can talk about this astrologically, so I'll do that just a little bit. I'm not going to go too much in depth here, but I've got here disturbance in the Middle East connected in with the major eclipse energy of October. Okay, we've had two powerful eclipses. The first one contained Mercury and the new moon in Virgo. Okay, and in addition to what I had said in the eclipse video I did, so I did do a video on the eclipse, and I'm pretty sure in that video I talked about things like relationships are going to be tested. Okay, I talked about something like a battle or something happening with skill and devoid of emotion. And that is this Mercury and new moon here in Virgo. And when I look back retrospectively now, you know, we can see the eclipse and we can see what this has been about on the world stage. One of the ways I would read Mercury in Virgo, if I'm reading that archetypally, to me, this is the person who's seated behind the desk and who orders a war but never fights in them. And that's how I see that Mercury in Virgo energy. And to me, it's kind of, it does remind me a little bit of what happened, you know, for example, I'm just using an analogy here. Because I feel like there's some of that energy here too, that there's somebody who orchestrates these things, but we never see their face and we don't know who that person is or those people. And that's what I think it is. And whatever the media is telling us, if the media is telling us that it's these people and they did this and they did that, I mean, I'm not tuning into the media right now at all. And I would be careful about what the media is saying, is what I want to say here. That's what I believe, because retrospectively, if we look at an event like, you know, what happened with the two buildings that went down in the United States of America, we were told what happened. You know, the media said their version of what happened, but many years have passed. We've all done a lot of research, and it's not what the media said at all. And I kind of get the sense that maybe we've got the similar thing going on here. If we look at that eclipse energy a bit further, we've got Mars and Ketu in Libra. So this is history that goes back through the generations. That's Ketu. We're looking at past generations. And when I was thinking about Ketu energy, and I was thinking about Ketu lords Magha Nakshatra. So then I was like, oh, I have to look up this eclipse. Was there any planet in Magha Nakshatra? And we did have. I've got here on the 14th of October, who was in Magha Nakshatra? Ketu's lord was in there, Venus. So this certainly is, that we're looking at tension in relationships that span back across generations. And that is certainly here. I've got here Mars in Libra. Again, Mars and Venus. There's a Mars and Venus connection. And I've got here, when I see these two together, yes, I do see passion, but I also see war, you know. And you'll see people who've got a Mars and Venus conjunction and things like that. I've seen people, great debaters can have those two together and things like that. But again, these are all placements that I'm exploring these as I go in my archetype series. By the way, guys, if you've been wondering where are those, I'm still going with that. I just had to pause because I've been doing so many things. I've been doing readings and videos and all kinds of things, but I'm getting back to that. That is just on hold for a short amount of time. As I was saying, that's just on hold for a short amount of time. Did I really just fill up a memory card there? Was that really 24 minutes? I have been talking a lot today. I think it's because I did a bit of Q&A at the beginning. But let's get back to this. So yeah, Mars in Libra. Now I've got here ancestral wounds, ancestral issues. And what I wanted to say here as well is just that, you know, because I'm studying this, as I said to you, I don't really understand the history. I don't know what's going on. I'm not able to talk about it. You know, you've just seen me talk about the no vote and the leave thing here in England. Here in these two countries, Australia and UK, I have opinions, you know, but with what's going on in this part of the world, I don't know. I really don't know. And I can't say too much. The way that I'm able to relate just a tiny bit, and I can't really relate. I mean, I'm hearing stories of what's going on there, and whatever those people are going through, like, you know, all the tests that I've ever gone through in my life are tiny in comparison to what people are going through there. So, you know, I'm not really able to say anything too much. But what I will say about ancestral wounds and ancestral issues is that we can relate, those of us who aren't there, the way that we can relate is that we've all been born into ancestral stories that perhaps we don't like or we're not proud of, you know. I was born in Sydney, Australia, and I look at Australian history and yeah, it's not good, you know. That's stolen land, you know. So it's very difficult. And this is why the spiritual path is so good. The spiritual path, not the religious path. That's another thing. I was thinking about all this, you know, and I was thinking about how, like with me, for example, so I've got two Indian parents. I was born in Sydney, Australia. I live in England. I don't have a flag. You know, I don't have a flag. In all the three countries that I'm authorized to live in by paper, if I go into one of those countries, everybody asks me, where are you from? You know, I don't have a land. I don't have a flag. And as I said, there's, you know, history that I'm born into. I was born in Sydney, Australia, and I'm not so proud of the history there, you know. So this is the thing with the spiritual path. If you're on the spiritual path, we've got things you can do, you know. You can learn forgiveness, you can learn to let go, you can learn to heal all of this stuff. There is always a pathway to peace, you know. And yeah, I just want to commit my life to peace and health, and that's all I want to do. And I feel that that's my way of helping, you know. I can't do much more than that. So yeah, this is a tough time in the world and a tough time in history. But you know, I was thinking about how we're all born into, I've got the line here, we've all been born into stories and systems we don't like. We've talked about that on this channel. We've all been born into, you know, we look at the monetary system. None of us like it. You know, we all think it's unfair, it's rigged only for a few, it's profiting off all of us. And, you know, yeah, I know the monetary system is not good. But one of the things that gets me through thoughts like this and gets my head out of just being lost in stories and history and the mind, you know, I get back into the body, get back into the heart. One of the quotes that helps me do that is a quote by Arthur Ashe. And it's just really, really simple. He says, start where you are, use what you have, do what you can. I'm pretty sure I got that right. Start where you are, use what you have, do what you can. And I love that quote. It's so simple. And it just helps me realize that nothing's perfect here. You know, it's really interesting that the eclipse, that big eclipse with Mercury and Virgo's there. That's chaos. It's a Dishtana house. It's a sixth house. It's absolute chaos in there. Why is Virgo all about perfection? And Virgoans are great, but Virgoans will get you to they're perfecting everything all the time. That's part of their energy. Why? Because part of their lives is chaos. They know chaos. And yeah, I think this is, you know, yeah, chaos has been part of this has been part of this eclipse. It's been really full on, guys. But what I know is, due to the spiritual path, there's always a pathway to peace, you know. And that's very 12th house as opposed to 9th house. 9th house, which is religion, you know. And again, like, I don't have a flag, I don't have a land. And, you know, I do have a religion. Hindu religion is what I gravitate towards, of course it is. Buddhism does too. For a time I used to do that Buddhist chant. That was the first chant I ever learnt, actually. Namyoho Renge Kyo. I used to do that. I used to do half an hour of that a day. I used to love that. That was a really beautiful chant. That's where I started with chanting. That was some years ago. But, you know, I thought about it. Like, if the government gives me a form and asks me to tick a box for which religion are you, I might not tick one, you know, because I'm spiritual. I'm not so much religious. So, yeah, there's a lot here that, you know, that is interesting. And I'm just wishing that there be peace in that part of the world. That's what I wish and hope and pray for every day. And if you are in that part of the world, please let us know in the comments below what's really going on and how life is for you. You can chat with us. We're here for you. You know, we've got really great light workers in the comments below as well, who are often offering help and things like that. So yeah, let's take a look. All right, let's take a look at the energy for November, and then I am going to get into the mini reports. Energy for November. So we've got here, we will enter November with the energy of the last eclipse of the year. Okay, so that is the eclipse that's going to happen on the 28th of October. We've got one more eclipse to go. And really, everyone, take care. This is an intense month, and take care of yourself. That's what I would sum up there. I've got here, November's energy will be intense, pressure cooker-like in nature. One of the reasons I say pressure cooker-like is because we've got that Saturn and Mars dynamic going on, and it's a mutual aspecting. So Saturn's 10th aspect is going to hit Mars. Mars's 4th aspect is going to hit Saturn. You know, it's this tense, intense energy. I've got the note that it could actually be hard to get things done, because Mars is wanting to get things done, but Saturn's gaze is going to be on Mars. And equally, Mars is casting aspect to Saturn as well. So yeah, this is tough. I've got here, the month could even be slowed due to a feeling of shell shock as well. Yeah, because Mars is going to be in Scorpio. And that's stagnancy, you know, due to trauma. I've got the note here, war is likely to continue in our world. I do think, because the war is connected in with the eclipses. So here's a long range prediction. I mean, this could go on for the next 6 months, but equally, the next really big time we're going to have big astrological changes, it's going to be March 2025. March and May, I think, 2025 are going to be, that's going to be the time window, March to May 2025, around there, we're going to have our big shifts again. So things could be tense here in this part of the world for up to 6 months, but equally, activity could be there for longer, up to about March, May of 2025. So I've got here, war is likely to continue in our world. We have a Sun and Mars conjunction across November. Sun and Mars together in my archetype series is the Commander-in-Chief archetype. Those of you who are watching that, the next one is supposed to be the Commander-in-Chief archetype, and I haven't wanted to record it as well because we got what's going on in the world. That's also why I've delayed on it a bit. I'm going to do Commander-in-Chief next, and I think after that is going to be Street Fighter, so stay tuned for those. But yeah, I've got here, for the first part of the month, Sun is debilitated until 15th, 16th November. After 15th or 16th November, Mars is in own sign Scorpio, but is in its debilitated pada until 21st November. So war is likely to continue. I've got here, when the Sun is debilitated, there is no justice in actions. And when Mars is debilitated by pada, but the Sun is recovered, there might be difficulty in performing actions, or actions will be performed out of emotion, but equally, due to emotion and shell shock, nothing may happen as well. So yeah, November energy is, I think it's some tough energy. I am seeing though that December should be better. I'll just go through these notes quickly as well. I've got here Venus will be exactly conjunct Ketu on the border of Virgo and Libra on 29th November. Rahu Ketu axis, according to True Node, would have just shifted on 28th November. Okay, so there is, you know, that's quite significant there. I've got here, this should mark a bit of relief as Venus heads into Libra and Mars and Sun won't be so conjunct. It is quite interesting across November, Mars and Sun are really very conjunct, which is that commander-in-chief archetype. It is the activity of, yeah, people commanding others, you know, commanding people in a war or something along these lines. I've got here Mars and Saturn would by then be out of Saturn's direct gaze. Mars and Sun, that should say. Mars and Sun would by then be out of Saturn's direct gaze. And there should be an easing of tension, some relief. So this is after 29 November. We should start to see relief. I've got here November is intense. December should be a lot better. Got here, December should be a month where order is being restored to some degree. We'll have Saturn in own house, Venus in own house, Mars in own house, and Sun in Sagittarius. Sun in Sagittarius is good. I've got here, the only thing challenging is Mercury retrograde, but it's really good energy there. Every planet has got their own house, and they're not bunched up. So it's better energy in December. It really, really is. December's going to be a better month, I really do believe. But if November's tense or intense, we've got astrology covering that. We've got reasons as to why. All right, guys, I think I'm going to start the mini readings. Those of you who would like to stick with me, stick with me. I'm actually just going to turn off the camera and start it up again because I've just realized I've let the... There's a thing I need to switch off, so I'm just going to do that and come back. Right, I'm back. Sorry, everyone. I just had to turn off my hot water system. It's just boiling up the water. I'm on an immersion system. I still don't have a boiler. Can you believe it? Anyway, it'll be repaired eventually. I'm basically on a backup system at the moment. It is what it is. All right. Aries, welcome Aries. This is Aries ascendant, Aries moon or Aries sun as per the sidereal Vedic system of astrology. Now for the first half of November right through to the 16th, we're going to have Sun and Mars in your seventh house. So that's going to be Sun and Mars in Libra in your seventh house. And this could be creating tension in relationships and partnerships of any kind, especially the person you're married to or in a committed relationship with. So things could be tense there. Got here, Mars is itching to get ahead, but Sun is debilitated. And this is all happening in Libra. So definitely take care of how you speak to others in relationships. If you are feeling tense, frustrated, angry, you know, take a breath, take a little walk. See if you can just leave it and come back to it when the emotion is run through. That's going to be better. Now, the second half of the month, Sun and Mars are caught in Saturn's gaze. Saturn's 10th aspect, you see, is going to be 8th house Scorpio for you. So this could be tiring, actually. You might feel tired. And some of your soul stuff, you know, might come up for clearing. What do I mean by soul stuff? If you've got old hidden emotions or hidden something that needs to come to light, that could come to light at this time. Something could come up for clearing. Now, Mercury is strong in your eighth house all month, and it's in Viparita Raj Yoga. So it's a good time to be strategic. It's a good time to make financial plans. it is a good time to do the behind the scenes admin that you've been putting off. So yeah, if you can make progress there, and Mars will be there. Mars wants something to do. So definitely do some financial planning, or if you have a website to make or something like that, you know, so there's something technical, something financial, something along those lines. Now there's a new moon happening on 13th November in Libra in Vishaka Nakshatra, which is happening in your seventh house. So with this new moon, I've kind of got a contemplation question for everyone. And this is just something to contemplate. Now you can make a wish here in the seventh house. You can wish for a committed relationship. You can wish to be married, you know, something like that, or for improvements in your marriage or healing in your marriage. But you can also contemplate this, and that is, what can you do in the now to improve your relationships? And you might get some kind of inspired idea of some small action to take, and that could be worth taking around this time. So what can you do in the now to improve your relationships? And there is a full moon on the 27th of November, Taurus Rohini Nakshatra, happening in your second house. It's a really beautiful full moon, and it's a good full moon to be at home with the family, to be grateful for the simple things. Aries, it is looking like a good month ahead for you. It could be a bit tiring, it could be a bit tense when it comes to relationships, but if you manage those two just fine, it is looking like a pretty good month ahead. Aries, I want to thank you so much for joining. We are now going to welcome Taurus. Taurus, welcome. Thank you so much for joining. So this is Taurus Ascendant, Taurus Moon, or Taurus Sun, as per the sidereal Vedic system of astrology. Now, for the first half of the month, up until about the 16th of November, we've got Sun and Mars in your sixth house. Sun and Mars in Libra in your sixth house. Now these two in this place could be creating a little bit of frustration at work, but they're in a good house here, both of them. So your Mars and Sun are actually very capable of getting a lot done here. So if there are some mild frustrations, it's okay. You keep at it, keep doing your work, because Mars and Sun are actually really well positioned. That's right up until the midpoint of November. You've got great energy here to get a lot done. Now, in the second half of the month, Sun and Mars will be caught in Saturn's gaze. Saturn is casting his 10th aspect into your 7th house in Scorpio. So relationships might actually feel stagnant. It could be that some of your soul stuff comes up for clearing. And by soul stuff, I just mean maybe old things, old feelings that you've hidden away or tucked away or swept under the rug to be dealt with later. Well, some of that might be dealt with at this time, because the sun's going to come and illuminate things in this area. So you want to be aware of that. The other thing is that Mercury is going to be in that same house, in your seventh house, all month. And Mercury is very analytical about relationships all month here in November. Now, for you, I'm not bringing up Venus for everybody, because I think I might do a breakout video for Venus. So actually, I'm just going to write that down, that I need to, I'm just adding more to my to-do list, Venus breakout video. But I'm giving you a little bit of extra info here, because I'm just a little bit concerned about this seventh house stuff. That's why I looked to Venus. I thought there's got to be some good news here somewhere. It's interesting, Venus is debilitated all month, so it's not particularly great news, but she is in the fifth house, and that is romantic energy there. So the note that I have here of advice is, don't let past hurts kill any flickers of hope. That might be needed for just a handful of you out there. You can let me know in the comments below, but that is the little piece of wisdom that I've got there. So don't worry if relationships aren't the best. You're going to have better transits coming up. Okay, so just hang in there with love life if it's difficult. Now, new moon, 13th November, Libra Vishaka Nakshatra, happening in your sixth house. So with the new moon this time, I've simply got a contemplation question for you. You could wish for something. It is a new moon, so this is sixth house. You could wish for next steps in career or, you know, progress in what you do in the world. You could definitely ask for that, wish for that. But in terms of a contemplation question, here's the thing to look at. What small changes can you make in career that are really going to help you in the long run? And I'm talking small changes, nothing big. What small little thing can you do? Could be learning something new. It could be upgrading your laptop. I'm not sure what it is, but there's some small change that you can do that's going to help you when it comes to career. And that's, you can contemplate that in and around that new moon energy. You might be inspired. You might get ideas there as to what to do. And then act, okay? Because Mars is part of this new moon. So that's why I'm thinking small actions when we're looking at this new moon. Now let's have a look at the full moon. Full moon is 27th November, Taurus Rohini Nakshatra in your first house. This is your full moon, Taurus. This is all about you. So I've got here, this is a full moon of true rest and deep gratitude for all the small things that make your life so precious. And it's really interesting. I was recently in the energy of gratitude. I try and be there a little bit every day. I usually am. But the last time I was in the energy, I was really in some deep gratitude. And do you know what I discovered? I discovered that I'm grateful for the simple things. I'm not grateful for extravagant things. Isn't that interesting? Like when I think about gratitude, and when I feel it really deeply, I feel grateful when I'm warm. I feel grateful when, you know, I've eaten a great home-cooked meal. I'm grateful that I've got a roof over my head. Like my gratitude really is about the simple things in life. And this full moon on the 27th of November, you can really feel into that strongly, Taurus. It's looking like a good month ahead, and definitely enjoy that first half of the month there. You should be able to get a lot done. All right, thank you so much, Taurus. We are now going to welcome Gemini. Gemini, welcome. Thank you so much for joining. So this is Gemini Ascendant, Gemini Moon, or Gemini Sun, as per the sidereal Vedic system of astrology. So now the first half of the month, up until about the 16th of November, we've got Sun and Mars in fifth house Libra. And that could be encouraging you to spend a lot, actually. This could be an expensive time, that first half of the month through to 16th of November. I've also got here, if you manage people at work, there could be frustrations with people at work or people you manage or your projects. There's something frustrating there. Equally, if you've got, you know, grown children and things like that, there could be frustrations with your children as well. So that's just something to bear in mind. Now, the second half of the month, we've got Sun and Mars caught in Saturn's gaze in sixth house Scorpio. So if you are disciplined and if you work with the energy of discipline, then Sun and Mars here in the sixth house could be massively productive for you. Okay, your Mars is in Vipreet Raj Yoga. This is really good. I've got here Mercury is strong for work all month as well. Wow, yeah, Mercury's in the six too. I've got here you can definitely rise above any sluggish energies this month with focus and discipline. So if you work with Saturnian energy, if you work in a focused way, in a disciplined way, if you are committed to what you're doing, you can be a real powerhouse this month, Gemini. You can achieve and accomplish a lot. Now, new moon is on 13th November in Libra, Vishaka Nakshatra, happening in your fifth house. So I've got here, what tiny thing can you do to bring more fun into your relationships with your partner or your children? And the reason I've got this question here, I know it's a new moon, so you could be wishing for something. So traditionally we do the whole, what are you going to wish for? It's fifth house. You could wish for a child, you know, if you're newly married or something like that. Equally, you could wish to fall in love if you would like to get married. You know, you could wish for creative ideas. You could wish for lots of beautiful things here on this new moon, 13th November. But because we've got Mars here, I'm being quite practical and I'm asking a contemplation question. And if you contemplate this question, you'll get some inspiration of something you can do. And so it's, what is that tiny thing you can do to bring more fun into your relationships with your partner or your children? So that's that new moon energy there. And the full moon energy, we've got 27th November, Taurus Rohini Nakshatra happening in your 12th house. So this is a really good time to reflect on your spiritual path and on your spiritual development. And you can reflect on what aspects of your spirituality are you really grateful for at this time. And this is something I actually do quite frequently just anyway. I'm frequently reflecting on that. I'm just grateful I'm on the spiritual path. I have gratitude just for that. I'm just so grateful I found it, you know. And David Hawkins talks about this. Dr. David Hawkins, he says that those people, you know, you're lucky in a lifetime to even just find the spiritual path. I agree with that. I think that's definitely something to be grateful for. Gemini, I'm loving the energy here for you. I think you're going to have a really strong month, especially if you work with the energies, you can really be very productive. So thank you so much for joining, and we are now going to welcome Cancer. Cancer, welcome. Thank you so much for joining. So this is Cancer Ascendant, Cancer Moon, or Cancer Sun, as per the sidereal Vedic system of astrology. Now, for the first half of the month, up until about 16th November, we're going to have Sun and Mars in fourth house Libra. And this will really put your focus on your home and your family life. There could be frustrations with your home or with your car or with your stuff as well. So just take care with all your things and everything. Could be frustrations with family members as well. Could be frustrations in relationship with mother. It's a possibility. I've just got the note here, take care. Now, the second half of the month, Sun and Mars are going to be caught in Saturn's gaze in fifth house Scorpio. So this energy, you might feel it as being a little bit draining or a bit difficult, especially at work if you manage others. It could be draining or difficult or some challenge or something with your children. Say, for example, if your children are grown up, it could be some challenges there. I've got here, Mercury is analytical and critical all month, and Mercury is in your fifth house. And I think the way to get through this month, discipline and putting your head down and getting on with it is really going to help. It's kind of like a don't expect too much from this month type of a month. Not the best energies, but don't worry. Everything's moving forward and everything's moving forward into better places. So don't you worry, Cancer. Now, new moon is going to be 13th November in Libra Vishaka Nakshatra in your fourth house. Now, with a new moon, I often say that we can wish for something, and this is happening in your fourth house. You could wish for a new home. You could wish for improvements to your home. You could wish for a new car, anything like that. But I've also got a contemplation question for you. And the reason I have that is because Mars is part of this new moon. So what tiny thing can you do at home or with your family relationships to improve life for all of you going forward? You know, and this could be something really small. This could be, I don't know, it's maybe you think your home needs a tidy up. Maybe it's as small as that. You'll be inspired though, and some idea will occur to you as to what you need to do around that new moon time. Now, we've got a full moon on 27th November, Taurus Rohini Nakshatra, happening in your 11th house. So this is a really good time to rest in gratitude for your friends or siblings and all that you've accomplished so far. This is a really good time to just look back at your journey and to recognize, wow, I've come so far. You know, and sometimes we really don't do that. Sometimes we're so busy trying to get ahead that we don't often stop and look back and see how far we've come, and that you might be living the life now that you wished for many years ago. So on the full moon on the 27th of November, Cancer, it's a really good time for you to honor and acknowledge yourself, honor and acknowledge how far you've come and how much you've done in this life. It's a really important thing to do. Cancer, I want to thank you so much for stopping by. We are now going to welcome Leo. Leo, welcome. Thank you so much for joining. This is Leo Ascendant, Leo Moon, or Leo Sun, as per the sidereal Vedic system of astrology. Now, for the first half of the month, up until about the 16th of November, we've got Sun and Mars in third house Libra for you. This is great energy, really good energy for you to be productive and to get a lot done. Now, though the Sun is debilitated, it really is strong in the third house. So don't be put off by that or worried by that. The Sun debilitated may make you a bit more empathetic, actually. So that's actually really nice energy here in the third house, because you may be working with teammates, others, peers, co-workers. Mars energy is very passionate this month and can really get ahead. Now, in the second half of the month, Sun and Mars are going to be caught in Saturn's gaze in the fourth house, Scorpio, for you. So it's not a great month to move house or deal with property matters. That's for the second half of the month onwards. Mercury is really strong all month in the fourth, so that is good. And Mercury is going to help you concentrate really well. This is great for your work. It's also great for students or anyone who's learning anything new. Speaking of new things, we've got a new moon. 13th November, Libra, Vishaka Nakshatra happening in your third house. So this is a new moon. You can wish for something because it's third house. You could wish for, you know, soul tribe friends to be introduced to you. Maybe you might wish for time to get on and do your hobby that you love to do. But because Mars is part of this new moon, I'm asking everyone a contemplation question. And this question for you is there a small thing you can do in your friendships or with your siblings to really make a difference? And what is that small thing that you can do to just improve the relationships with people around you? And if you contemplate this question in and around that new moon, you might be inspired with an idea of some really practical thing that you can do to make an immediate difference in your life. Because of that Mars energy part of this new moon, I do believe, you know, we can make a difference here. Now, there's a full moon happening on the 27th of November, Taurus Rohini Nakshatra, happening in your 10th house. So a work project could culminate and complete at this time. And regardless of whether that's the case or not, this is a really good day on the 27th of November for you to feel grateful about where you are work-wise. Okay, so even if you're in a job that you don't like, look at how far you've come. Look at maybe several years ago, you were in a different place to where you are now. Equally, if you're not working, maybe be grateful for exactly that. Be grateful for the opportunity to go at a slower pace, to look after your physical body more than you've ever done. You know, if you're not working, maybe you're able to sleep in, maybe you're able to, you know, have a long shower and just really do all the self-care things that you never had time for before. You know, periods of rest where we're not working is vital. We need that in life. So, there's something here on the 27th about finding gratitude for where you are in life. And that's going to be a really good thing. Leo, I want to thank you so much for stopping by. We are now going to welcome Virgo. Virgo, welcome. Thank you so much for joining. I'm just checking the time. We're okay. Now, the first half of the month until 16th November, Sun and Mars are going to be in your second house, in second house Libra. Now, this isn't the best energy at home or with family. This could be kind of tense, actually. I've also got the note here, if there's no problem with family, it could be that it's hard to save money this month. Equally, it could be both of these things being impacted. I've got the note here, be patient. Better energy is in the second half of November, okay? So it's not far. It's just that first half of November could be just a little bit tense, a little bit pressure cooker. Like, I've got here, be careful with how you speak with your family. You know, if it's better to go for a little walk in nature or just take some time out, take some time out. Now, second half of the month, we've got Sun and Mars caught in Saturn's gaze in third house Scorpio. So this is beautiful energy. I've got here now, you're feeling more energized and ready to achieve big things. Mercury is analytical and critical all month there in the third house. So take care in relationships, even for the second half of the month there, yeah. I've got here, tune into your heart energy whenever you remember. So if relationships are a bit of a challenge for the month of November, just tune into your heart, sink into your heart. You know, don't use your mind. Don't over rely on your mind or overthink. Now there's a new moon, 13th November, Libra Vishaka Nakshatra, happening in your second house. Now, for every new moon, I typically say things like, you know, plant a wish, you know, plant a seed, make a wish. And with the second house here, you could wish for big savings, money. You could wish to buy something beautiful that you want. You could wish for something for your family. You could wish for your family to all come together. There's lots of beautiful wishes you could do here. But because we've got Mars as part of this new moon, I'm giving everyone a contemplation question. And this is so that you're inspired to think up ideas. Now, your contemplation question is, what small thing can you do at home to make life easier? So if you contemplate that question, what small thing can I do? Ideas will come, and maybe it'll be something you can implement, you know, straight away kind of thing. It'll be interesting if that works for you. But this is a beautiful, practical sort of a new moon. Now on the full moon, on 27th November, we've got a full moon. As I was saying, we've got a full moon, 27th November, Taurus Rohini Nakshatra, happening in your ninth house. So something culminates or comes full circle regarding things you've been learning. And I've got here the note, be grateful for your teachers, your books, your knowledge, because you're going to be able to share all of that. And that's really important. One day you'll be able to pass all of that forward. And don't put any pressure on yourself as to when that is. That will happen. So I always think, yeah, we acquire knowledge for some reason. The main reason is to share it. Virgo, I'm liking the look of the energy for you, especially second half of the month onwards. Energy is really going to lift and improve second half of the month onwards. Virgo, I want to thank you so much for stopping by. We are now going to welcome Libra. Libra, welcome. Thank you so much for joining. This is Libra Ascendant, Libra Moon or Libra Sun, as per the sidereal Vedic system of astrology. Now for the first half of the month until 16th November, we've got Sun and Mars in first house Libra. This could be tiring. This is all for you, Libra, yeah. It's all happening in your sign. This could be draining or tiring physically. Okay, so just if you're feeling tired, if you're feeling a bit run down, just rest. Don't push yourself. I've got here gentle exercise or walks in nature will be really helpful. It'll just help you ground, help you feel perhaps a bit more energized actually. And it's an interesting one. Sun and Mars could be energizing in the first house. See how you go with it, but I'm definitely seeing it could be draining or tiring. I'm seeing that. Now Mars has a fourth aspect on the house of home, so do take care how you speak with family. That might be important. Now in the second half of the month, Sun and Mars are caught in Saturn's gaze into second house Scorpio. And again, I've got the note, it's okay if you are tired, do rest. It's a really good time to clutter clear. If you haven't done a clean out or a clear out of your place for a while, could be a good time to just do that. Mercury is really strong all month in your second house, so that's beautiful. You're going to speak with confidence and style. The words will flow. You will just be on it, okay? Mercury is a terrific planet to have in the second house, especially when it comes to speaking. So that's lovely. Now, if it's not used speaking or teaching or any of those things, you could use your Mercury to sort out financial matters. So this could be, yeah, a really good time to get stuck into your finances and just organize yourself, sort things out. Any admin that you've been putting off for a while, it could be a really good time to just blitz it, just get it done. Now, there's a new moon, 13th November, Libra Vishaka Nakshatra, happening in your first house. So with every new moon, I often say that, you know, you can plant a seed, you could make a wish, that kind of thing. Now, this is your first house. So Libra, you could really wish for anything that's going to make a difference to your life. Equally, though, this is a new moon that includes Mars. I just want to double check that. I am quite sure I've got that right about this new moon, but just let's just take a look at 13th November here. Yeah, absolutely. Mars is definitely in the mix here. Yes. Yes, very much so. So I have been saying the right thing this whole time. Sorry. I just wanted to double check. Because we've got Mars as part of this new moon, I'm asking everyone a contemplation question, and you can get some immediate results here. So if you contemplate this question, maybe you'll be inspired with an idea that you can implement straight away. So the question is, what tiny things can you do or change? Well, for you, this is all about Libra. So yeah, what tiny things can you do or change that will make a huge difference in your life? Now, what those things are, I'm not totally sure. This is something I frequently do in my life, though, in my day. It's kind of like I'm always sort of optimizing. You know, I'm always sort of looking at the little systems of my life and can I improve them? And it's a bit geeky, but, you know, I did do an IT degree, so it's left over from that. But we did study things like just-in-time management and, you know, all that sort of thing. And I like all of that. And this has that kind of feel. It's kind of like, what tiny things can you do or change or optimize? Or some little improvement that you make that's like, I'm so glad I did that. You know, it's really made a difference. This is a good time to strategize and think about that. You could get some inspired ideas that will just come in. And it's like, oh, I'm so glad. I'm so glad I did that thing. Now, there's full moon on the 27th of November, Taurus Rohini Nakshatra, happening in your eighth house. So there could be some kind of completion regarding a family issue or something to do with your in-laws. This could be personal in nature. This could be to do with your subconscious. This could be something culminates and completes. Maybe there's just some phase of your life that you're done with, or a style of thinking that you're done with, or you don't need to be that way anymore or do that thing anymore. Or, you know, this could be something quite deep and hidden as well that just closes out for you and it just frees up space and energy. This could be really beautiful. Got the note here, on the full moon, 27th November, this could be a really good time to contemplate what you are grateful for in terms of your family and your home life. What are those things? And with gratitude, what I've found with gratitude is that I'm actually grateful for the simplest of things. You know, that's where I experienced my most highest levels of gratitude, actually with the really simple things, you know, and that's the beauty of gratitude. It's easy to be grateful, actually. It shouldn't be too hard. Libra, I'm loving the energy here. You know, even though, I mean, you do have some challenging things up there with Sun and Mars being in the first and second house. That's not the best, but I think there are some beautiful energies here for you to work with and to grow with, you know. This could be a month of a lot of growth, a lot of spiritual growth. I want to thank you so much for tuning in, and we are now going to welcome Scorpio. Scorpio, welcome. Thank you so much for joining. So this is Scorpio ascendant, Scorpio moon, or Scorpio sun, as per the sidereal Vedic system of astrology. Now, for the first half of the month until 16th November, Sun and Mars are in 12th house Libra, and this could be making it difficult for you to get solid sleep this month. Now, Mars will aspect your third house, giving you some energy for your hobbies. You can do what you love during the day or do more of it and perhaps sleep will be better at night if you're quite busy during the day. Now, in the second half of the month, we've got Sun and Mars caught in Saturn's gaze in first house Scorpio. This could be draining, this could be tiring. If you do some gentle exercise, take some walks in nature, that might help. Now, Mercury is going to be analytical and critical in your first house. This is actually good energy to strategically review aspects of your life, but it's also going to be important for you to tune into your heart and tune into what do you really want? What do you really desire? What do you really want to create? So you've got some good strategic energies here, but do tune into your heart as well. How do you feel about things? You know, life isn't all just strategy and money and work and all that kind of thing. What do you really want? Who are you really? Who are you at heart? Now, there's a new moon, 13th November, Libra, Vishaka Nakshatra, happening in your 12th house. So with every new moon, I always suggest to people you could wish for something. This is happening in your 12th house. You could wish for spiritual insight. You could wish for downloads. You could wish for improvements in your intuition. You could wish for a stronger connection with the divine. The all is one. There's a lot of things you could wish for. But because we've got Mars as part of this new moon, I'm saying to people, contemplate this question and you might actually get some practical guidance as to what to do. So the contemplation question for you is, what small thing can you implement on your spiritual path that's going to make a really big difference? And that is something that is going to be different for everyone. You'll get some inspired ideas come through, something that you can act on almost immediately. Now there's a full moon, 27th November, Taurus Rohini Nakshatra, happening in your seventh house. So something might come full circle in regards to your relationship. And this is a really good time to reflect on what you're grateful for in all of your relationships. Or, you know, yeah, what aspect of relationships do you really love? What are you grateful for when you're in a relationship, when you're in a good relationship? You know, what things are you grateful for? And this is reminding me of Lester Levinson, what he discovered. When he looked back on all his past relationships, he discovered that the part that he enjoyed most was when he was loving the person, not so much when he was receiving the love. Obviously, it's wonderful to receive love. But what he discovered on deep contemplation was that he actually got more joy from giving the love. Isn't that interesting? All right, Scorpio, thank you so much for joining. We are now going to welcome Sagittarius. Sagittarius, welcome. Thank you so much for joining us. This is Sagittarius Ascendant, Sagittarius Moon, or Sagittarius Sun, as per the sidereal Vedic system of astrology. Now, for the first half of the month until 16th November, we've got Sun and Mars in 11th house Libra. This is great energy for success, great energy for achieving things, for getting things done. Maybe you're going to be a bit social here. Maybe you might meet some new people. Now, even though the Sun is debilitated, it's strong as per house placement for you, okay? So this is good. And Mars has the energy to create here. So we've got really good energy here. Now, the second half of the month, Sun and Mars are going to be caught in Saturn's gaze in 12th house Scorpio. So this could impact your sleep. And what you might want to do is exercise a bit more during the day. That will help you to sleep well at night. Now, Mercury is really creative up here in the 12th. So this could be a time where you're actually able to channel your own inner guidance. I've got here, keep a dream journal, or you could even try this thing called morning pages. I think if you just Google search morning pages, I'll see if there's something I want to put by my side when I'm editing, or I'll see what I find. But I'm sure I did watch a video about this, like a 4 or 5 minute video about morning pages. And what you do basically is you take some paper and a pen and you just write down, just like stream of consciousness, just write down what comes, just whatever, just a brain dump, just put it on paper. And what people have found is like this amazing and profound wisdom comes through. I did try it. I think I need to try it more. I think I need a transit like what you've got, and then I'll try it. I'll try it when my Mercury's going through my 12th house. I'll have a go. But yeah, I like these kind of things. It's quite fun. So you could try that morning pages thing. Let me know in the comments below if you do try it or if you have tried it before and what it was like for you. I did, yeah, do that for like a few days, but I think you need to do it every day for like a month or something. So you've got the right transit to do that across November. There's a new moon 13th November Libra Vishaka nakshatra happening in your 11th house. So with each new moon, I typically say you could wish for something, you could plant a seed. It's in your 11th house. You could wish to meet new people, soul tribe, you know, that kind of thing. But I'm putting forward a contemplation question because there'll be some inspiration that comes around the new moon of something you can do more immediately. And I've got here, what's a tiny thing you can do to bring in more income or to bring in more opportunities or to help you be more creative in life? What's a tiny thing you can do to help that? And what you'll find is if you contemplate that around this new moon, some ideas will come. You might be inspired. Now there's a full moon happening on the 27th of November in Taurus Rohini Nakshatra happening in your sixth house. So something might come full circle at work or in a legal case or some domain of life where you are competing or you're in competition for something, but something comes full circle. And I've got here the question, you can do a contemplation question here too, and that is, what are you grateful for when it comes to your work? Sagittarius, I'm liking the look of the energy here for you. I want to thank you so much for tuning in, and we are now going to welcome Capricorn. Capricorn, welcome. Thank you so much for joining. I'm checking the time. We're okay. Now, first half of the month until 16th November, we've got Sun and Mars in 10th house, Libra. Okay, this is really good energy for work. This is good for creating work projects, getting things done. This is good for creating your career path. If you're currently not working, this is good energy to be building a career path that you want to be on, you know, or building your way to a career path that you want to be on. But there's something about creating the path here. You're co-creating with the universe. It's that kind of energy here. I've got the note here, even though Sun is debilitated, it is strong as per house placement. Sun loves to be in 3, 6, 10, and 11. So it's a really good place where the Sun is here. Mars is very happy here too. You really can be very productive here, Capricorn. Second half of the month, Sun and Mars will be caught in Saturn's gaze in 11th house, Scorpio. I've got here, if you work with discipline, you can achieve a lot. So just work with that Saturnian energy. So yes, you know, we've got these planets stepping into Saturn's 10th aspect, and that's happening for you, 11th house, Scorpio. But work with that energy. You really can achieve a lot. This is actually good entrepreneurial energy as well, Saturn's Sun. Okay, when we do the archetype series, you'll see. I've put a pause on the archetype series. I'm going to get back to it soon. But Sun and Saturn are, for me, the entrepreneur archetype. And so you got a lot of entrepreneurial energy here. If you want to start a business, I think that's where earlier I was sort of saying, you know, you're creating your work path. I can kind of see that here. Got here, Mercury is super creative and strategic in the 11th house. Beautiful. Got here, this can help you communicate brilliantly all month. Good. Got here, work energies are good for you this month. And you are in the last phase of Sarisathe Capricorn. Hang in there, keep going. This is great energy for you to do a lot of work. And with Sarisathe, what people often find is that their work is solace. Their work is, oh, I love work, you know, because everything else might be not going so well, but it could also be that work is tough too. Look, I know that. I had a Sarisathe that was, yeah, everything was pretty tough. But there will be some aspect of your work where it's just you and your work and the world, you know, no boss, no teammates, just subtract all of that. And just you and the work, You know, something about that should feel good. And just aim to be with that. Aim to put your head down, do your work. Saturn is going to reward you, okay? Even if it's going unrewarded now, don't worry. He catches everyone up. He gives in bulk, you know, when he can. He really does. I've seen it with so many of my clients, you know. There's a new moon happening 13th November, Libra, Vishaka Nakshatra happening in your 10th house. So with this new moon, typically I say you can plant a seed, you can make a wish, and that's in your 10th house. So you could be wishing for that dream job, you could be wishing for stepping stones to get there, you could be wishing for opportunities or for your projects to succeed or something like that. But we've got Mars as part of this new moon, so there'll be some inspiration around this new moon for some practical thing you can do to get some immediate results. So the contemplation question I have for you is, what is something small you can change to make your life easier at work? And whatever that is, that could be something that prevents RSI. That could be, I need to buy a cushion for my chair at work. You know, it could be as simple as that. Could be bigger, I don't know. But yeah, that you'll be inspired. Now on the full moon, 27th November in Taurus Rohini Nakshatra, this for you is happening in your fifth house. So something might complete in your love life. Something could complete in your relationship with your children. It might be an old dynamic or pattern that you've outgrown and that you're ready for new things, or you're ready for the next layer or some new thing to happen here. I've also got the note, reflect on what you're grateful for in these areas. And the thing that you're grateful for with these relationships might just be that those people are there, you know? Gratitude is an interesting energy, and for me, gratitude is when I'm really grateful, I'm grateful for really simple things. Sometimes I'm just grateful for the presence of a person, just that they're there, they're alive. You know, sometimes I'm just grateful for that, you know? Something really basic and but good that you could be feeling really grateful for here on the 27th of November. Capricorn, I'm wishing you well. Take care. We are now going to welcome Aquarius. Aquarius, welcome. Thank you so much for joining. This is Aquarius Ascendant, Aquarius Moon, or Aquarius Sun, as per the sidereal Vedic system of astrology. Now, for the first half of the month until 16th November, we've got Sun and Mars in 9th house, Libra. This could be causing frustrations with authority or with people around you. Could also be to do with siblings or cousins or something like that as well. Could also be to do with father as well, relationship with father. Could be bosses, you know. But there could be some frustrations in these relationships here. So just take care. Don't push it, or don't push your agenda. Just let stuff go, all the spiritual stuff, right? You know, take a walk, all of that, if things are intense. Now, the second half of the month, we've got Sun and Mars caught in Saturn's gaze in the 10th house. So Saturn's 10th aspect is going into your 10th house, Scorpio there. And I've got here, this is much better energy than the first half of the month for you. Yeah, it is. But it's going to require discipline for you to activate this energy. So second half of the month, you really do have some fantastic career and work energy, but it's going to require discipline. It's going to require effort and work and commitment and responsibility and all those Saturnian things. Now, Mercury is work focused and strong in the 10th house. So this can really help you communicate beautifully all month. Work energies are really good for you in the second half of the month. So that's great. Now there's a new moon happening 13th November, Libra Vishaka Nakshatra, happening in your 9th house. So with every new moon, I typically say, you know, this is a time where you can wish for something or you can plant a seed. It's happening in your 9th house. I mean, you can plant a seed for some long distance travel here. You know, you could wish to go somewhere, you could wish to learn something new, you could wish to enroll in a degree program or something like that. But because we've got Mars here with this new moon, I'm giving everyone a contemplation question. If you contemplate this question, you might start to get some ideas and be inspired to do something more immediately. So the question for you Is there a little thing you can do to help you learn more each week or each day? And I really like this question. I've actually implemented this. I've got this little notebook. Oh, it's in here. It'll probably wobble the camera, so I won't. I've got like a little filing cabinet thing here. I would get it out and show you. It's this cute little diary thing. And what I've decided is when I get an inspiration, I'm just going to jot it down in there. And this little diary thing, it fits in my handbag, and I just love it. So I'm hoping that that little tweak is going to help me capture more of my insights. Because very often I think of things, and then but then there's go out of my head as well. Now you've got a full moon on the 27th of November happening in Taurus Rohini Nakshatra in your fourth house. So something might culminate or complete in the area of home or family or to do with your stuff or the things that make you feel comfortable, or maybe if there is a delay, something to do with your home. Maybe you've been wanting to get repairs and there's a delay there. Something could culminate or complete, or it's like the next step, or there's movement, or something completes and then you're free to go. It's something like this happening there on that full moon. Aquarius, I do realize that some of you are in Sadisati, so the moon, Aquarius moon people are in Sadisati. I hope you're doing okay with that. I'm wishing you well. I'm looking at the energies here. I mean, hi Aquarius, the camera got cut. Sorry about that. What was I saying? And now I've kind of lost my train of thought because I also just had a sip of water as well. I think I was talking about the full moon. And I was probably saying something about, that you're in Sadisati. Aquarius moon people, Sadisati, that's it. Yeah, hang in there, Aquarius. I mean, you've got good work energy here. I'm really happy about that because I think I might have just said this to Capricorn people. I'm going to say it to you now as well. Work is a solace. It's work is a place of, oh, thank God for my work when in Sadisati because Saturn wants you to work hard. He's probably testing you personally and emotionally and in all kinds of ways. But there will be an area, and it could be work. Maybe you're being tested at work, but you're okay in your relationship. Basically, what I've seen with Sadisati is that there is typically some area where, you know, you're okay. And be in that area. And I know for me, it was work was my solace. When I had my Sadisati, and when things were really tough, it was like, yeah, sort of, I could feel like the world was falling apart. But in my work, I just put my head down, did my work. And it's real sort of humble, no ego, no agenda. I just want to work. I just want to work hard. And that somehow was therapeutic and helpful. That's not always a good coping mechanism because sometimes we rely on that too much and that can be a bad thing. I'm kind of undoing some of that actually, where I'm not working so hard all the time. But yeah, it's sometimes you need to in life. Sometimes it's a good thing. Actually, gosh, I am just looking at the screen. It's quite interesting. I don't know if I'm just going to clean this. I don't know if this is going to... Sorry. There we go. I've just cleaned up the viewfinder. Is that better? I think it might be. Oh gosh, that was dusty. I've got this. It's a little, it's a lens cleaner. It's also a laptop cleaner. Anyway, I'm going down tangents. Maybe, do one of you need this? No, there's one of the thingies I've said that they need to do clutter clearing. It's not you. But anyway, I'm just seeing there's still more dust. Oh, this is driving me crazy. I'm just going to clean it. Sorry, because I never look at this thing with the lens on. Anyway, I'm so sorry to take up your time. Aquarius, someone needed that. I think there's a cleaning message there for someone. I don't know. Someone needs to clean up something because I never do that. That's like the first and only time I've ever done this. All right, well, somebody needs that message. Somebody needs maybe to clean their phone screen or their laptop screen or their camera lens, I don't know. Aquarius, thank you so much for joining. We are now going to welcome Pisces. Pisces, welcome. Thank you so much for joining. This is Pisces Ascendant, Pisces Moon, or Pisces Sun, as per the sidereal Vedic system of astrology. Now, for the first half of the month until 16th November, we've got Sun and Mars in 8th house Libra. This could be causing frustrations with family or in-laws, okay? Some of your relationships, it could be a relationship with partner as well, could be frustrating at this time. I've got here, equally, this energy could also be tiring or draining physically as well. Now, for the second half of the month, we've got Sun and Mars caught in Saturn's gaze. Saturn will be casting his 10th aspect into 9th house, Scorpio, for you. So this could create challenges or argumentative energy with superiors, with bosses, with people in authority, possibly with father, possibly even maybe with siblings as well. I've got here Mercury is analytical and critical in your 9th house. And Mercury might be the logical impulse in you that's making you want to speak up. But I've got the note here, it might be advisable to say less and simply put your head down and do some work. You know, that might be the better way to go rather than speaking up here. But use your intuition, you'll know what to do. Pisces, you're Pisces, you've got great intuition, so you'll know what to do. Now, there's a new moon happening on 13th November in Libra, Vishaka Nakshatra, happening in your 8th house. So for all the signs, with a new moon, I typically say, you know, what seed do you want to plant? What do you want to wish for? And we've got a new moon in 8th house. You could be wishing for, and it's relationships, it's Libra Vishaka Nakshatra. I mean, you could be wishing for soul tribe people, actually. We've got Libra here. We've got 8th house, but you could also be wishing for a healing to do with relationships. You could wish for something to really heal and lift and shift. You could wish for some healing in your subconscious to do with relationships. Okay, there's lots of different things you could wish for. But because it's a new moon that's got Mars part of it, I'm asking everyone a contemplation question, and this is a contemplation question where you might get ideas, you might get some inspired ideas of things that you can implement quickly, more immediately, and see some results yourself. So the contemplation question is, what small thing can you do that will help you and your family? And this could be a really small thing. Now, I've got a couple of examples here because it's 8th house. I've got here quite literally clutter clearing, or even something to do with the rubbish or something like that. I know with my place, I reorganized my kind of my little rubbish bins and how all of that's sorted. And yeah, it's so much better and it saved me time and it's more efficient and, you know, and the reason I'm saying rubbish is because we are looking at the 8th house here. But this could be something practical like that, but this could be something else. What small thing can you do that will help you and your family? I mean, because it's 8th house, this could be emotional in nature or subconscious in nature or to do with dynamics and patterns. This could also be something like, you know, what small thing can I do that will help me and the family? Well, it could be something like, well, I'm going to stop being critical of my family, or it could be something like, I'm only going to offer advice when it's asked, right? Is that a small thing or is that a big thing? You know, I actually think that might be a big thing, but that's an important thing. That's an important rule to have. Only give advice when you're asked. To me, that's the first rule of healership. You only step in and do something if somebody asks. Yeah. But as I say, it could be some small thing. It could be something to do with organizing the rubbish bins. You know, I don't know. I don't know what this thing is. But see when what this contemplation question brings for you around that time. You might get some inspired idea on actions that you can take. And we've got a full moon on the 27th of November in Taurus Rohini Nakshatra happening in your third house. So something might come full circle in your friends group or to do with a sibling. This is also a really good time to just be grateful for the people in your life. Just be grateful that they're there, you know. And that's one of the things that I like in relationships. I like to look at the level of, I'm just happy that they're there. You know, I'm just happy that they exist. Sometimes when we see a person in that way, that's I tend to think that's very beautiful. And we're just happy that they're alive and well, you know? That's a really beautiful thing. Throughout this, as I've been going through the zodiac and talking about, because the full moon for everyone, I've been talking about gratitude. And one of the things I've been sharing along the way as I've been going is that for me, when I'm deep in gratitude, I've discovered that, like, I'm grateful for the simplest of things, the really, really simple things. My gratitude doesn't have anything to do with extravagance or the fancy things. Those things are nice, don't get me wrong, I love all of that, you know, that's all good. But, and it's nice to have things to aspire to and you know, you want this or that, or that's all wonderful. But when it comes to gratitude, I've discovered, yeah, gratitude is always something really simple and basic. Like, I'm grateful that I'm warm. I'm grateful that my breathing is clear today. You know, I'm grateful that, you know, I've got a roof over my head and all that kind of thing. Gratitude is so powerful and so beautiful as well. So what are you grateful for? And if you're a Pisces moon and you're going through the Sati-Sati, how are you doing with that? I hope you're okay. It has been a tough month. October has been a really, really tough month. I think November is going to be a tough month as well. If you didn't watch the intro, I have talked about the fact that the energy of November, you know, we've got, it could be a bit intense. It could be pressure cooker-like. It could be sluggish or slow for some people. It could be emotional. It could be people just dealing with shell shock. You know, November's tough. But then I do see that December is a better month. I think we're ending the year in a better way. December's not looking too bad. In fact, some things about December are looking quite good. So we all just need to keep hanging in there. And at some point, I do want to take a look at the fact that, I mean, we're finishing up a 7-year now. I haven't done this before. I haven't done like a Vedic numerology thing. I really want to, yeah, I don't know. I might do a thing talking about the 8-year next year, but it's a Saturnian year next year, 8. And I've been thinking about that. And yeah, I mean, I think, you know, for those who are working hard, and those of you who are in Sati-Sati, this is something I said to one of my Capricorn clients. I actually said to her that I said that, is work a solace for you? Is work a really beautiful place for you? She said, oh yeah, work's been great. So if you're in Sati-Sati, you're Pisces moon, you're in Sati-Sati, look at that. Look and see if work might be an area where it's actually, you actually just feel fine. That, wow, I can just put my head down and work hard and just do lots of work and that feels good. It could be like that, that you might find that work is a solace across this time. Saturn rewards the hardworking. Saturn loves hardworking people. He loves hardworking people. He loves honest people. He loves those who do self-love and learn what that means. Self-love is not so easy. Really, it's not, self-love is not having a bubble bath on a Friday afternoon. I always say that, it's a bit of a cliche now on the channel, but self-love is more than that. Self-love is discovering what is true health, you know. So Pisces, I'm wishing you well. It is getting late here in London town. It's past my bedtime. I'm just looking at the time there. 13:13. Wow. That means I should wrap up. I think 13 is 13 the death card in tarot. Am I being told to wrap up the video? I think I am. Guys, I want to thank you so much for tuning in. Thank you for the comments you leave and the likes that you leave. Every single bit of interaction helps keep this channel going, and it helps keep this channel growing as well. I want to thank you for tuning in. I'm wishing you well. I'm wishing you safety wherever you are in the world. Stay well, stay safe, and I look forward to seeing you next time.